Good morning. All right, I can tell there's been a lot of fellowshipping going on, but let's just take it up a notch and get up and say good morning to some of the folks around you. We would like to offer a special welcome to anyone who may be visiting here with us for the very first time. You will notice that there is a space on the flap in your bulletin. We would appreciate it if you would complete that. And at the end of the service, just tear it off and drop it in one of the offering boxes. There is one in the back under the clock and another one out in the foyer. Mark Sullivan has a special announcement for us. While he's coming, let me remind you that there is a semi-annual business meeting that's coming up right after the service and luncheons. There will be food. And everyone is invited to attend. Whether or not you're a member, you are invited.
Morning, everybody. So this is a call to all hungry men. These are men that were hungry for food and fellowship. On October 16th, which is a Thursday at 6:30 p.m., we're going to meet at Mystic Pizza for just hanging out, some food and fellowship, and that day also happens to be Boss's Day. So, you know, treat yourself to some good food, some good company, and we look forward to seeing you. So this will be Thursday, October 16th at 6:30 p.m. at Mystic Pizza 2. It's not in the bulletin, but we will have it in the bulletin next week. And there is a sign-up sheet out in the foyer. If you could just put your name on so I have a good feel for how many people are going to be attending, that would be awesome. So. Look forward to seeing you guys.
Thank you, Mark. Okay, as you all probably know, we are gearing up for our 25th anniversary of the church celebration. A couple of things. They are putting together a kids' song time. There's more information about that in your bulletin. So if you've got some kids that might be interested in helping us celebrate, please read that, and you can see Colleen. There she is. I knew she was there somewhere. Also, we are in need of words and pictures of your time here at Grace Fellowship, whether you are a newbie or you've been with us for the whole 25 years. We need to get that information in. It can be emailed to anniversary@gracefellowship.org. That address is in your bulletin along with some additional information. Really need to get it in by the 5th of next month so they can coordinate all this good stuff and put it together. So, if you'll rise with me, we will consider God's word.
The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quieten you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing.
Heavenly Father, we are so blessed. Lord God, not only do we come to worship you, but you rejoice over us. That is almost unimaginable, that the God of all creation would rejoice over those who have come to him. And Lord God, we are so grateful for the intimacy of the relationship that we can have with you through Jesus Christ. We thank you for that. And we thank you for allowing us to worship you even as you rejoice over us. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. May the grace, God's grace, and his peace be upon us as we gather together and worship him with him and together. I praise God in this world of change and trouble. As Hebrews 13 says, the Lord Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, the same today, and the same forever. In Psalm 66, we can say, how awesome are your deeds, God. So great is your power that our enemies cringe before you. All the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to your name. And if, as we do, as Hebrews 12, 22 and 3 say, if we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, We will not grow tired, weary, or lose heart. Jesus is the name above all names.
To read that just sort of sums that up. And if you don't know him today, you need to know him. Here I am, I stand at the door and I knock. If any hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me.
And see.
God for the joy in the morning.
Praise the Lord. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you today and just help us to just leave all the challenges of life in the rear view right now and just come before you and just place it all at your feet. Lord, help us just in this moment to worship you with all our hearts, with all our minds, with all our soul, and all our strength. Lord, we come before you and we just know that you have what's best for us. And we know that salvation comes through no other but through you. Lord, pray for all the people that are hurting right now. I pray for the people in our congregation that are going through some difficult times. I pray for those who are struggling financially, physically, emotionally. Lord, place your healing hand upon them. Show them your hand of grace and love. Lord, we think of Peggy Hartel's daughter, Kathy, especially right now, all the pain she's going through. I pray that you would just work in that situation in a way that only you can, and in a way that when we look back on it, we'll see that that was you, that was your hand working. Lord, I also just think of just outside these walls to the world around us. We see in just so many ways that this world is broken, and a lot of issues that we just kind of want to cover up are starting to come to the surface in a lot of ways in sports, in entertainment, and in politics. And so, Lord, we just pray that you would place some of your people in positions of leadership that could show people the right way, the way to you. They would show people how to deal with these situations, that we don't just try to figure out what's right and wrong on our own, that we need you to show us what's right and wrong. We need you to show us how to deal with these things, that we don't have the wisdom in our own lives, in our own minds, to come up with the right ways. We can only do so much, and we need you. And so, Lord, ultimately, what I want this prayer to be is just a declaration of our independence, our dependence on you. And Lord, we just want to lay down everything we have right now in this moment before you. In your name I pray, amen.
You may be seated. And children, you can be dismissed for Children's Church. I'm going to ask the adults to turn to Acts chapter 16. And take care, kids. Well, I notice a familiar face in the audience. I hope the parents know. But JD, is that JD back there? No? JD, man. Hey, stand up. Yeah, just so we know, you're still alive. It is good to see you, and you don't need to give a speech, but can you give us a thumbs up, like boot camp? We know you survived. You're here. Okay? And, we've been kind of tracking, at least through his parents, just the many cool things that have been happening in your life, JD. Maybe some Sunday you can just share those with us if you're here long enough, but it's been neat to see JD go to boot camp and see the Lord work in your life, man. So, amen, brother. So cool, you guys, okay? You can say cool, cool. Well, anyway, I'm going to ask you to turn to Acts chapter 16, where we're going to look at just a small portion of Acts. And I know you just sat down, but who doesn't need to burn calories in the room, right? So please stand up for the reading of God's word. Pastor, speak for yourself, right? Acts chapter 16, I'm just going to read verses 1 through 5. He came to Derbe and to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived, whose mother was Jewish and a believer, but whose father was a Greek. The brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. Paul wanted to take him along on the journey, so he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was a Greek. As they traveled from town to town, they delivered the decisions reached by the apostles and the elders in Jerusalem for the people to obey. So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in numbers. Well, God in heaven, again, we ask that you would teach us through your word. Father, all of us come here today with different burdens. We're on different journeys in life. We see things differently. We struggle with a variety of things. And so, God, I pray that your word would speak loud and clear to us today. And so we thank you in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, who is your role model? Who is your role model? I know in this past few weeks, especially in the NFL, people have been questioning those who have a place in the NFL, and are they role models? But let me ask you, who is your role model? For example, if you're a baseball player and you want to learn how to hit well, and this is a bone to you Yankee fans, maybe Jeter is a role model to you. And you can, you know, it's okay. You can say something. You can clap, whatever. And so Derek Jeter is what an incredible hitter. And actually, you know, even being a Red Sox fan, you just have to say, as he's coming towards retirement, he has played his game, and he's played his game well. Maybe you're a football player and you aspire to be a quarterback, or you just love football and can really appreciate that. And so maybe you like Peyton Manning, who won, what was it last year, Kevin? The Super Bowl, that's right. And so Kevin back there is a huge a Colorado fan, and so maybe Peyton Manning, and up to this point in his career, he has conducted himself with a stellar career, and you know, if he were to retire today, you just have to tip your hat to him, because he's been an incredible quarterback. Or maybe you're a couple, and you're looking for a godly couple to emulate, or maybe you're even a preacher, and you're looking for a godly preacher to emulate. And so I know some of you young people don't know who this is, but maybe you want to consider Ruth and Billy Graham. Billy Graham and Ruth. And so they have been an incredible couple that have served as an example in the Christian community. I think she makes, Ruth makes an excellent example for you ladies who are in the military, as her husband was away a lot, in a different kind of service, but was away a lot. And yet, who can't look up to Billy Graham, who has conducted his evangelistic career with integrity? You see, we all pattern our lives after somebody. And today, I'd like to introduce to you somebody that we can follow, we can look to as an example. Now, when we begin to look at the book of Acts, we see this, that this small little book, we see a number of different things. But ultimately, the book of Acts is about the historical account of the Acts of the Apostles. Some say the Holy Spirit. You could do that. You could say that as well. But Acts is a historical account of the Acts of the Apostles as the church developed under the sovereign hand of God. And so as we look through this book, we see how the Lord directed people and events. We see the sovereign purposes of God that are fulfilled through people and events, and actually converge as events and people converge to even fulfill Old Testament prophecies. We see the work of the Holy Spirit as he infiltrates the church, and the church is born. And we see how the Spirit of God empowered people for godly service. We also see, though, man's depravity as well, in living color, as some seek to serve Christ, others are seeking to stone them. And so we see man's depravity in living color. We see the beauty of the church. You know, as the Acts and as the apostles and the disciples gathered together, we see in Acts 2, and they broke bread together, they had fellowship together, they studied the word together, and they were unified together. And just what a beautiful picture of the church in the book of Acts. And I think that's probably why, for pastors, the book of Acts is just one of our favorites, because it does present to us that model of what a good church is. We also get to see, though, key people as they emerge in the storyline, as Luke writes this incredible account of the history of the church, and key people arise. And one of those key people happens to be Timothy. Timothy emerged as a leader in the church. And we see he's introduced to us as Paul goes on to his second missionary journey. And you can see, and Abby, maybe you can help me out here. They start off in the purple. They start off in Antioch, and then they go on to Tarsus. They go on to Derbe and Lystra and Iconium. And there in Lystra and Iconium, Paul meets a young man. On the first missionary journey, we see that a young man came to know Christ, and his name is Timothy. But here, Paul is reacquainted with a young man named Timothy. And what I would like to propose to you tonight, today, is simply this, is that he is put forth to us as an excellent role model. Now, I can imagine, too, that some of you might say, what does my life have to do with Timothy? Timothy was a young man. I mean, late teens, early 20s. And so you might say, why is he an example to me if I'm maybe a lady and, you know, I'm well along in years and I'm thinking, why would Timothy be an excellent example? And I just want to tell you, wherever, whatever stage you're at, if you're older in the faith, if you're younger in the faith, if you've been in the faith for a while, or if you've just come to know Christ as your Savior, Timothy is an example to us, and I want to share with you why I believe that he is an excellent example to us, and why, in a sense, you kind of wish that every church was filled with Timothys. And so, why was Timothy an excellent role model? And we see, first of all, that Timothy, he chose the right examples. Everybody, I believe, patterns their life off of someone. We probably do that more often than you think. We're always looking for someone to pattern our life after. And Timothy patterned his life after the right people. He chose to follow the right people. And so we see here in Acts chapter 16, it says Paul came to Derbe, then to Lystra, where a disciple named Timothy lived. And we're given some inside information about him. It says that whose mother was Jewish and his and she was a believer, but whose father was a Greek. And so here we have Timothy, and he has two people to decide to follow. His father, who was Greek, who was followed after the pagan gods, possibly, we don't know for sure. Or he had his mother to follow. And we know this from the scriptures that Timothy patterned his life after his mother and his grandmother. Turn with me to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Paul is writing to Timothy, and he says in verse 4 of 2 Timothy chapter 1, recalling your tears, which really kind of tells me something about Timothy as well. He was certainly compassionate and a tender person. He says, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice. And I am persuaded now lives in you. And so here is a man who chose the right example. He followed after his mother, the pattern of his mother. My friends, who are you going to follow after? And here is a challenge to you parents, that we are called to set an example for our children. Are we leaving something behind for them to follow? In a few weeks, a couple of the men will go to Spofford Men's Conference in New Hampshire, and there the title of the conference is Leaving a Legacy. What kind of legacy are you going to leave behind, parents, for your children? This isn't just for young parents, but this is for grandparents as well. And it doesn't matter if your children are young or old, what are you leaving behind? It's your responsibility to leave a legacy behind, a spiritual legacy, but it is their responsibility to choose it. It's not all on you. And so Timothy chose to follow after the pattern of his mother and his grandmother, and he chose to follow their sincere faith. We also see, however, that he also followed after the pattern of the Apostle Paul. Paul himself was an example to Timothy, and Timothy followed after. We see that Timothy was probably converted through Paul's ministry when the apostle first visited Lystra. And so we see, if you want to jump over to 1 Corinthians, chapter 4, verse 17, he says, for this reason, I'll start at verse 16 of 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, therefore I urge you to imitate me. So Paul is calling on the Corinthians to imitate himself, and he says, for this reason, I am sending to you Timothy, my son, whom I love, who is faithful in the Lord. You see, Timothy followed Paul's pattern of living. And so he says, to the point where Paul could say, he will remind you of my way of life in Christ Jesus, which agrees with what I teach everywhere in every church. And so Timothy followed after the pattern of the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul was his example. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Simply says this. Paul said to the Corinthians, he says, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. And so here we know that Paul intentionally laid down a pattern of living for not only Timothy, but the entire church of Jesus Christ. He is somebody that we can follow after. We can follow after his example, just as Paul followed Christ. And this is the way the church is to make disciples. We are to follow after the pattern of those who are mature in the faith. Turn to John chapter 13. In John chapter 13, we see Christ's love for the church as he served them. He says in chapter 13, verse 1, having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. So Jesus showed his love to the church. And so in verse 15, we see this. He says, I have set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. And so Timothy not only followed the faith of his mother, he not only followed the example of the Apostle Paul, but he followed the example of Jesus Christ himself. Ultimately, that's who we follow after, the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, basically, I have this one question for you. Who are you following? Who are you? I'm not saying you're, well, we know that you're following Jesus, or you ought to be, but who is your example? Who is your role model? I asked that to somebody here in the church this morning, and they said, my dad. Hip, hip, hooray for dad. And so may we be like Timothy and choose the right examples. And you know, unfortunately, so many of us choose the wrong examples. Maybe in our elementary years or in our teenage years. You know, I've seen so many young Christians who they've grown up under the umbrella of their home, and then they go into, like, say, a Christian college, and then they let loose. You know, and I understand there is a response to freedom there, and they're living their oats, but at the same time, so often we forget the person that we ought to be following. Who is your example? One other aspect to Timothy, and I believe why he is a great role model for us to follow, was because he was well spoken of, and it's just simply here in the text. It says, the brothers at Lystra and Iconium spoke well of him. In other words, Timothy had a great reputation. Now, here's something unique about Timothy, as we already saw. Timothy's mother was Jewish and yet a believer in Jesus Christ because she gave her life to Christ, most likely in Paul's first missionary journey. But yet, his dad was Greek, and he most likely grew up in a Greek education, with a Greek education, and probably lived within Greek culture, obviously. And yet, both groups spoke well of him. He earned the respect of the Gentiles and the Jews, which I believe was probably not easy, to the point that Paul wanted to take him along on the journey. Paul did not want John Mark on the journey. We have no idea necessarily why Mark deserted Paul or left Paul and Barnabas. But there was something about Timothy that was so attractive that Paul wanted to take him on the journey, and I believe it was because he had a good reputation with the community. Do you have a good reputation with your community? I'm not just talking about your physical neighbors, but with the people you work with, the people you socialize with, your friends. Do they speak well of you? Young people, if you're looking for a job, you're going to find out pretty quick that that employer wants references, because they want to know, are you a person of integrity? Do you get along with others? Are you a team player? They want to know something about you. They want to know what others think of you. This is important. And so whether or not you're a student, or whether or not you're in the marketplace, do you have a good reputation? One day I had the opportunity, and I think I've shared this with you a number of years ago, but when I came to know Christ, I worked in a copper mill. And in that copper mill, you know, you cut copper tubes, and you do all kinds of things with tubing. There, that was completely, if I could say, ungodly to the max, to the nth degree. Well, you know, if I was a religious freak, if I could use that word, and came down on everybody and was judgmental of everybody for every swear word that came out of their mouth and every thought that was uttered, I probably would have been looked at as religious, but not sure if I would have been well spoken of. But by God's grace, I developed a great friendship with these guys. I loved them, man. I enjoyed going to work with them. It was a blast. And so I quit because I kind of thought, man, I got to do something else with my life. And so I went to college and was working on a business degree, and I needed some money. And so I decided to answer this ad for cleaning with Service Master Cleaning Services. And he says, well, I want you to show up to this address because we're looking for somebody to clean the building. And lo and behold, I knew exactly where it was. It was the copper mill. And I walked into the copper mill, and there was the maintenance supervisor. And you know, I mean, I'm not bragging on myself, but it just taught me a lesson. He says, we'll take him any day of the week. And I was hired. And it was so cool on one hand because it was like coming home, and I spent 4 years there cleaning toilets. I know how to clean a toilet. But don't ask my wife. I know I clean about 40 to 50 toilet bowls a night. And then, one day I was sick, I was tired, I kind of had the flu, and I did not show up for work. And most people would have been fired, but in a sense, they knew me. And I just said, look, man, I was sick, I had the flu, I was tired, I just couldn't come in and clean the building. And it was before cell phones. You know, I cleaned the building at 1 a.m. in the morning. Who are you going to call then and say, come in, can you clean the building? A good reputation will take you many different places. God will use that reputation. But you have to develop it. What about you? Do you have a good reputation in the community? Now, I didn't even get to the fact that the Apostle Paul spoke highly of Timothy as well. If you want to turn to Philippians, what a raving endorsement. Here the Philippians are in trouble. They need some help. And Paul is sitting in prison. So who is he going to send? Who is he going to send to help the struggling church? Who is he going to trust? Well, he says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 19, I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon. Aha! Timothy, I can trust. I can entrust Timothy with these problems. I can trust him because he's got a good reputation. He is spoken well of. And so he says, I hope in the Lord to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. And listen to the raving endorsement he gives concerning Timothy. He says, I have no one else like him. In other words, he is unique. He is, in a sense, set apart. Now, how is he unique, or how is he set apart? The idea it carries with it is just simply this. They are like-minded. Timothy and Paul were two very different people. As a matter of fact, Timothy was timid. We're told that he's told to be courageous. Do you see the Apostle Paul being timid? No. Do you see the Apostle Paul lacking in courage? No. They were two very different people, different ages. But what Paul is saying here is he's saying, Timothy is like-minded with my spirit. We think alike. When it comes to ministry, we think alike. And so I can trust him in this assignment. Man, what a joy it is to work with somebody when you are like-minded. And I have had the opportunity to work with a number of different people, very different, but we were like-minded. I am so thankful for my former pastor that I had the opportunity to work with for 17 years. We were different. Sometimes we saw things differently, but we were like-minded in ministry. I am so thankful to have the opportunity, and I don't mean to put Bob Williams on the spot, but I am so thankful to have the opportunity to be here and to minister to you. And just when I talk with him and when I come to him with my problems, you know, my spirit jives with his spirit, and there is a like-mindedness, and yet very different, even probably in some areas of theology, but very different, but there is a like-mindedness there. And so Paul says concerning Timothy, I have no one else out of Barnabas, out of Silas, out of Mark. I have no one else out of Peter, no one else out of Luke. I have no one else like him. Wow. And he tells us why. Because he says, everyone, I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. He takes a genuine interest in your welfare. Timothy cares for people. He cares for people. He's not after it for himself. He's not looking to fulfill his own agenda. He is in it because he cares for people. Do you care for people? I see oftentimes so many people, even in ministry, that they're using ministry for their own purposes, for their own cause, to prop up their own reputation. Timothy is in it because he cares for people. He says, for everyone looks after his own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. You see, Timothy could have followed after everybody else who was looking after their own interests. But no, not Timothy. Timothy looked after the interests of Jesus Christ. And so he says, but you know that Timothy has proved himself. In other words, he's been tested through fire. He's been tested through persecution. He's been tested because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. And so here is a man who cares for others, cares about the gospel of Jesus Christ, and works well with others. He is a man of good reputation. He is well spoken of. And finally, I believe that Paul, or Timothy, is a role model for us because he had a passion to reach others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. He had a passion to reach others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you say, where do you get that from the text? Well, let me first say this. Because he was willing to go with Paul. And we know that. He was willing to go with Paul. Now, you see, his passion to reach others with the gospel of Christ was so much that he was willing to suffer for the gospel. He knew of Paul's past persecutions and sufferings. If you want to turn to 2 Timothy again, Paul wrote to Timothy, and he says in verse 3, beginning at verse 10, he says, "You, however, know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, my faith, my patience, my love, my endurance, but you also know my persecutions and my sufferings. And you know what kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and in Lystra." This is Timothy's own area, his home area. He says, "The persecutions I endured." Well, what persecutions did he endure? We see in Acts chapter 14, verse 19, that when Paul went into Antioch and went into Iconium, some of the Jews and some of the troublemakers, they won the crowd over, and they stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. So Timothy saw that and knew that that would be his lot as well in some way, shape, or form. Now, how many of you would be willing to do that? Would you? I pray and I hope that none of us have to give our lives for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But are you so passionate to share the love of Christ and the gospel of Christ, are you willing to suffer? Are you willing to go take the hard knocks for the gospel of Jesus Christ? Timothy was. And that's why Paul wrote to Timothy, and he says in chapter 2, verse 3, "Endure hardship with us like a good soldier of Jesus Christ." Endure it. It's not easy. It's painful, but endure it. You see, this man was willing to suffer for the gospel of Jesus Christ. But we also know this, that he was willing to lay down his rights. And that really is kind of one aspect or the crux of this passage. He was willing to lay down his rights so that he could minister the gospel of Jesus Christ to all people. And so we see here in Acts chapter 16, it says this, "So Paul wanted to take him along with him on the journey," and this is kind of strange, but it says, "So he circumcised him because of the Jews who lived in that area, for they all knew that his father was Greek." So here they are. They're carrying a message, which was the conclusion of the debate at the Jerusalem Council. And that message was simply this, that you do not need to be circumcised. You do not need to follow the law of Moses to be saved. So then you step back and you say, well, why did Paul take this young teenage man and have him circumcised for ministry? And it's because of this. It's because Paul knew that it would offend the Jews if he wasn't. And so Timothy was willing to be circumcised. He was willing to lay down his rights. He didn't have to be, but he was willing to lay down his rights so that he could serve others. I know we use this text as a proof text for many things, but I believe this is why Timothy was circumcised, because he wanted to remove every obstacle there could be so that he could serve and minister with integrity, not only to the Gentiles, but to the Jews himself. And this is why Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 9:19, "Though I am free, I belong to no man. I make myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but I am under Christ's law. And I did it so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all men so that some might be saved. Amen. And so every once in a while, God calls us to lay down our rights for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. My friends, are you willing to follow Timothy's example? He was well spoken of. He followed, or he chose, the right examples for his life. And he had a passion to reach others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Are you? Let me pray. Father in heaven, I pray that we would be willing, Lord, to allow you to be glorified in our lives. Father, we're not perfect. We all have scars or marks from the past. Any one of us could accuse us of many different things. But I pray, God in heaven, that as we seek to honor and follow you, we will follow Timothy's example, Paul's example, and more than anything else, Christ's example. So, Father, in my life, Lord, be glorified. In Christ's name, amen. Please stand with us and let's sing this song. I want you to make this your prayer, this isn't a song just to sing. If you need to kneel, then I want you to kneel. If you need to get down on your knees, then get down on your knees. But make this song your prayer. Business with God, and you need to just sit down in your chair and just quietly take a moment and talk with Him. And if that's the case, then maybe everybody else could scoot on without you. But it's our prayer that in your life, in your church, and in your home, Christ would be glorified. want to just take this moment to invite you for lunch in the fellowship hall. And again, where we get to glorify God even through just the conducting of a business and being accountable to one another. So may he be glorified in your life. Amen and amen. Have a great day. Thank you.